Welcome to Breadboarding. This video includes all my tips for building reliable projects using breadboards, in particular building digital microcomputer type circuits such as the NanoComp series that you can find in the playlist on the site here. This includes additional suggestions on top of those from Ben Eater's tips video and includes some information I've found out about the reliability of USB power supplies which may be of interest. So I think the most important tip I would suggest is watch Ben Eater's breadboarding tips video. I've shared this previously on the earlier introduction video, but Ben's video here is about 20 minutes long and includes most of the tips he has on how he does the layout, how he cuts the wires and everything else. So I'd strongly recommend reading that first, and then once you've done that, come back and we'll carry on. So what are the things coming on leading on from Ben's tips? Well, from quite a lot of the sites I've come across, people who've been replicating Ben's projects do describe problems with the power supply voltages when they've got many breadboards daisy chained together. So the main thing I've found is don't daisy chain more than about three breadboards together and try and use direct connections from the power supply to groups of breadboards. Now, there could be issues to do with ground loops, earth loops and things like that, but in general, with the digital electronics, it seems to be more a matter that the power supply needs to be direct as possible and certainly not going through multiple connections on breadboards. And I've got some examples I'll show you once we've gone through this slide where I can make this obvious to you. The other thing that Ben says is he tends to use 0.3 of an inch to strip the ends off wires, and when he has to do short distances, he tends to use the manual wire strippers rather than the automated ones. I found that probably 0.3 of an inch is slightly too long, and the strippers that I use will do about 0.5 of an inch from one end, and then what I do is cut the required insulation and then slide the insulation so there's about 1/4 of an inch at each end. I find that easier than using the manual wire strippers for short lengths. I also found that quite often when you're making these smaller 3 and 4 hole lengths, which are quite often needed for the positive and ground rails, that it's actually quite cumbersome doing this many, many times. So what I've done is made a small jig of the holes with the right lengths for 3 and 4 hole wires. And I'll show you in a minute how I do that. It just means I can create 4 or 5 in a go, and it's a lot quicker than doing each one manually. And then finally, a lot of Ben's videos show using a USB power supply to power the circuits. Now, by default, most USB power supplies should be able to do 0.5 amp, 500 milliamps, and probably are rated at 1 amp or 2 amps. However, what I have found is as you start to go over about 500 milliamps, the voltage can start to drop, and some power supplies are better than others. So again, once we've gone off this slide, I will show you a couple of power supplies I've got and how their voltage varies with increasing load. So let's have a look at daisy chaining breadboards first. So this is an extreme case. I'm not suggesting you ever do this, but I did this as a demonstration of the effect. What we have here is, I think these are 12 power rails and they're daisy chained together, and the way how this is done is so that the power will go all the way down that side, all the way up that side, all the way down that side, all the way up, zigzagging up and down, which has got to be about the most inefficient way of doing things. But I thought it'd be quite useful to just put a meter on to show a few different things. So to start with, what we're going to do is to measure a resistance. And what I will do is to measure resistance. We want to just join together the two rails at the end here. And then what we're going to do with our meter here, is you're just going to measure the resistance between these two lines at the top here. What we have here. So we have about 2.4 ohms. Okay. Now 2.4 ohms across, we've got 12 power rails here, and obviously we've got double the distance because the power's going all the way along each one of these up to here and then back again. So we've effectively got 24 lengths. So it's about 0.1 of an ohm per power rail. And obviously, if we're saying that we don't want to really daisy chain more than about three breadboards together, that's probably about 0.3 of an ohm we're likely to have. So that's really where the justification comes from. Now, what I'm also going to do whilst we're doing this is one of the later points is also about the parasitic capacitance that exists on these boards. So whilst you've still got it wired up like this, I've switched it on to capacitance meter. And what we can see here is because we've effectively got the capacitance in parallel of each of these lines here are effectively in parallel. And so what we've got here is when you add capacitors in parallel, then you get the sum of their capacitance, unlike resistance, where you get less resistance within parallel. Capacitors, we actually get them added together. And what we can see here is we've got 0.32 nanofarads. So that's 320 picofarads as a result of this particular connection. So that works out probably approximately about 20-25 picofarads per power strip here, but it's something that certainly is worthwhile bearing in mind when we look at things a little bit later on. So that's the power issues. We're going to come back to this particular board again in a minute when we look at the USB power supplies. What I was going to show now is my preferred approach for doing the cutting the wires. This is the type of tool that Benita suggests and prefers. I must admit, my one maybe not as good as his, but I don't find it as easy to use these as he does. And in fact, when needing to produce lots of short wires, so when we look at this one here, if you're producing lots of short wires that you need to do to tie things to ground or to VCC, then it can get a bit dull and boring. So what I do is I set my automatic wire strippers like this. I cut half an inch off the end. What I've done then is I've got this sort of jig that I've made where I've got a three-hole one or I've got a four-hole one. Just stick it in there. Chop it off level. Crimp the next one. In the three-hole one. Chop it off level. Now, obviously, you can repeat this as many times as you want, but and then the holes are big enough such that they fall out quite easily. Then all I do is go to about half of that length there, push the insulation up, which normally goes quite easily, push the insulation up, and then twist. Similarly, push the insulation up, and then twist, and then this one, I haven't done that very even, see there, but similarly, do the same thing here, push them up, twist, and then twist. So we can create a sort of three and four hole lengths quite easily, and you can do this sort of five at a time. So that's how I do these. I would also say that I find that this particular wire stripper tends to do 0.25 of an inch by default. So that's the default length. When you look at these on the on these calipers here, so we can just about see that's 0.25 of an inch. Recut this to be a third of an inch. So this one now is closer to Ben's suggested size. What I found with these is that when I plug a third of an inch into boards, there sometimes is just a tiny little bit of wire showing. Whereas when I use a quarter of an inch, then the wire tends to bed quite nicely in there. So it's a very, very minor issue, not really a big deal. So that's the wooden jig as well. And then finally, we'll get on to the power supply. I have a couple of high high wattage resistors. So these are 10 ohm, 10 watt resistors. One 10 ohm resistor across 5 volts will draw about half an amp. So if we put these in parallel, we can go up to 1.5 amps. And if we put them in series, if we put two in series, we'll get about 1/4 amp. So what I've found with these is that the different USB power supplies are varying levels of performance when doing higher currents. So this is an old iPod Apple charger. It's quite an old one. I think this is rated about 1 amp. Output 5 volts, 1.0 amps. This is one that came with my desk lamp. Again, this is rated about 1 amp, 5 watts. And this is an old ASUS adapter for a tablet. And this is rated at 2 amps and, rather worryingly, also is capable of providing 15 volts as well. So it's one thing I'd never realized in this thing. So what I'm going to do is to plug in various adapters, and what we're going to do then is to measure the current and the voltage. So I've got my eBlog voltmeter here, and I've also got another old ammeter here, which I've got wired up for doing current. That's on the 10 amp scale. And what I'm going to do is to use a similar type of lead to what Ben uses in his video. So this is just a USB-A with the positive and negative wires. And I have got the data wires available if I need them, but they're insulated there. So what I'm going to do is to try each of the adapters initially just with, get rid of that one for the moment, initially just with 250 milliamps. So we're going to do that with two of those resistors in series. So if we do this without any resistor in, then you can see here at 5.1 volts, 0 amps. That's now got 20 ohms across 5 volts, which should give us 250 milliamps. So if you see here, we have 0.25 of an amp, and the voltage is not bad, 4.975. Let's just do it for the other adapters as well, just whilst we've got that there. So this is the no-name brand from my desk lamp, LED desk lamp here. Again, that's 4.895. and 0.24. And if we now try the ASUS tablets one, and again 4.981, not too bad. And these resistors will get a little bit warm over a period of time. The wires are not that thick, but they should be able to handle 1 amp or so. So what I'm going to do now is to take those out of series, and we've now only got a single resistor here, so we're now expecting about half an amp, which is right. And we now have about 4.84 volts. This is starting to get a little bit warmer. And now I'm going to add another resistor across here. So this is now going to give us almost an amp going through these two resistors. So let's just put this other resistor in here. And you can see now that hasn't quite gone up to an amp, and the reason here is the voltage has now dropped down to about 4.6 volts. So 4.6 volts is a reasonable drop, and if we combine that with some of the other circuits, I'm going to put in place the daisy chain power supply, and we'll actually see what a dramatic effect that can have. So we've got 1 amp being drawn from a 2 amp power supply, and we're obviously not getting the same amperage out here because the voltage is quite a bit lower. So we've lost 0.35 of a volt there. Right, so if we unplug that, I'm now going to plug in this into the circuit, and what we're going to do here is to see what happens Firstly, with just the one resistor, and then we're going to put in place this whole daisy chain thing and see what the voltage comes out there. So this is about 0.48 of an amp, just under half an amp, and we've got 4.885. So now we plug this in and let's see what we get. So previously we had about 4.8 volts, and what you can see now is, as a result of all the resistance in the daisy chained board here, we've only got about 4 volts going here. So this is getting to a stage where we might actually start to see a problem. And one of my later tips is, I've got a very small voltmeter, digital voltmeter here, which is quite a handy little thing. And if you put this on the power lines at the top here, you'll see that it will give me approximately, you know, just under 5 volts. But if I put this down where I've got my power, put the meter on the far furthest ends of our breadboard, and it gives us a sort of indication of what the voltage is at the far end of the breadboard. So we can see here, there we go. That's the better way of showing things. So you can see here that my main meter here is 4.067 volts. This is 4.09. The little meter's probably accurate to about 1%. What I found is, on a very large breadboard circuit, I've actually put one of these in the corner, and it just indicates if there's any sort of power problems. Certainly power problems can be one of those things that are very difficult to diagnose what the issue is. So let's just try this is the Apple one with 1 amp. We can see here 0.9 and about 4.7 volts. Try my power supply for my other lamp. That is 0.95, slightly better in fact. It is designed to give 1 amp, slightly more modern this one. It's fairly new, whereas the iPod charger is probably 10 or more years old. Then finally, we have the ASUS one doing 1 amp. And that is only about 4.7 volts. Now, in fact, the ASUS one is theoretically capable of doing 2 amps. So all I'm going to do now is to add another resistor. I'm not going to go up to 2 amps. I'm just going to. So now we have a 2 amp power supply, which is supposedly capable of doing 2 amps, and is now only showing 4.6 volts. So we've lost 0.4 of volt. If you combine that with some of the other chained power rails, I've seen on one board I was working on where I wasn't aware of this, that about 3.6 volts, and that started to cause real problems with some of the cathode ray tube controller CRTC chip that really didn't like working at 3.6 volts, not unreasonably really. So that's my follow-up to Ben's breadboarding tips. There's a few things here. The USB 5 volt power supply thing is something certainly to be aware of, and in a later video I'll show the Hammond Tech desktop power supply I have, which was fairly reasonably priced. If you just took 4 things out of these tips, these are them. Now, the using high quality breadboards is being covered in the introduction video already. There's 3 separate YouTube sites that have done reviews of the different breadboards, and really the Busboard Prototype Systems ones or Janeco ones are the ones which are recommended. The Busboard Prototype Systems ones, certainly from the UK, are about half the price of the Janeco ones from Amazon. Janeco is about twice the price as Busboard Prototype Systems. The post power supply issues that I've just shared: don't daisy chain more than 3 breadboards. Use direct connections from the power supply to groups of breadboards. Certainly up to about half an amp, you shouldn't really have any problems with power supply voltages. But as you start to go over half an amp, any sorts of resistance in the power lines, together with any voltage drop on your USB power supply, is almost certainly going to result in problems. The next one is clarity, really. The biggest improvement I think I found is using chip pin layout labels stuck to ICs. This not only makes it easier to see what's going on, it also reduces your chances of hooking up things incorrectly, hooking the wrong pins. Now, the guy who I've referenced before, Grant Searle, has a great website, and on that he has a PDF of some chip labels that he's produced, and I'll show those in a minute. When building and projects, build and test them in small incremental steps. In the early days, I tried to build an awful lot all in one go and would build the whole circuit, and then it would be quite difficult to diagnose problems and things. So I think it's a lot easier to build and test projects in small incremental steps, do the processor, then perhaps get that working, then add the ROM, get that working, then add the RAM, then add peripheral adapter, then add the display, then add the keyboard. You keep on adding things incrementally, you're only changing a small amount of things. And if you do need to change the layouts, there isn't quite as much work to do if you're building things incrementally. So those are the sort of four things that I would say. If you do those four things, you will have a much higher chance of succeeding. And if I show you the chip layouts, so this is Grant Searle's website, and then about three quarters of the way down in the home built micros, there is a link for chip labels, and you're not allowed to reproduce this page without permission. The PDF is here. So this is the PDF. It's got a lot of really useful ones. It's got the 6809, Z80, Z8. It's got a lot of the chips that you would want to use, 6850 serial interface, and quite a lot of EPROMs, even a 68008. So I use this, I still continue to use this, so thank you, Grant, for sharing this. And I've also, for those chips that Grant hadn't done, I have used a scalable vector graphics application called Inkscape. Mine aren't quite as pretty as Grant's. I think Grant may have used Visio for his. But I've done similar ones for those chips that weren't included. And so what I do here is save them in PDF and print them out. And basically, when they're printed out, these are the Grant Searle's ones. So I tend to print them out. You do need to make sure you print these out in. There are some instructions that Grant supplies for printing these out. You need to make sure you don't have any scaling or fit to page or anything like that, otherwise they won't come out quite the right size. And these are the ones that I've done, my own ones. So these are mine, and I've added extra chips and things here that Grant didn't include. Okay, so what do you do there? And you just cut them out and stick them on top of the chip. This is a glue stick, Brit stick in the UK. Just use this to glue labels on the chips, and it works pretty well. So that's showing the chip labels. So one of the things I mentioned in the first video in the introduction was that there's quite a lot of comments on various websites to do with why you shouldn't use breadboards, they're unreliable, etc., etc. Now, I think a lot of the issues of these have come from perhaps people using the cheap and cheerful breadboards, which aren't always the most robust and most reliable. But I think as well, some of the other tips I'm sharing with you will help to alleviate some of these issues. There's a particular Stack Exchange conversation that I've referenced here. Quite a few of the comments and things, particularly to do with stray capacitance, parasitic inductance, what frequencies to work at. I think the main thing is if you try and use this for analog or radio circuits or oscillators or anything like that, it certainly isn't going to work very reliably. But for digital electronics, with the types of tips and things that I'm sharing with you here, I think you can build quite reliable, robust circuits. So if we go back to here, also the Busboard Prototype Systems does say within their specification that their breadboards are rated for up to 36 volts and 2 amps. So for any sort of 5 volt, 3.3 volt microcontroller, microprocessor type work, you should be absolutely fine. And obviously, even the putting 1.5 amps through those resistors that I was showing earlier should be perfectly within the limits of the breadboard. So other things about improving reliability. Well, key thing here is make sure you use the right sort of wire. So if I switch over to the workspace. So this is 22 AWG solid wire. This is just a standard pack from Amazon. It's quite neat dispenser reels in there, but I find it quite useful. And the colors that I use and the color scheme that I use is based on the fact that these are the colors it comes from. But if you use a dispenser like this and use the lengths of stripping of the wires that we've mentioned, so 0.25 of an inch is what I use, then you should find that all your connections are long enough. Even if the wire pulls out a little, it will still leave a good connection. The next one there, including a mini voltmeter in the breadboard furthest from the power supply. So that's one I've already shown you, the little digital meter. It cost about £1 or £2, I think. And that would have saved me an awful lot of time if I'd have had that on the last breadboard in the chain. It would have identified sort of problems and things much sooner than I'd otherwise done. One of the other things I would say is, it's not been a huge problem for me up till now, but potentially could be in subsequent users if you're reusing breadboards and things, is what I would suggest is, when putting certain components, so things like push button switches, for example, this particular push button switch, the leads are quite large, and although you can force them into the breadboard, it's probably better not to. And so what I would suggest there is making little riser cards. This is out of a bit of strip board, ferro board, and you're probably better to use the circular PCB pins rather than the square ones. These are some square ones. I think the circular ones fit a bit better. And so generally you'd put two pins in there, perhaps take the middle pin out. Yeah, you can pull the pin out and just leave two soldered in there. And the advantage of doing that is it will plug into your breadboard quite neatly, and it won't strain any of the pins, so that when you come to reuse the breadboard in future projects, you don't have problems perhaps caused by the contacts being spread apart by the very wide contacts there. There's another item that's another on the next page. If you're using certain components, this is a zero insertion force socket, for example. The pins on this really weren't long enough to plug into the breadboard reliably enough. So what I ended up doing is soldering two rows of these sort of pins to it, just to make it a bit longer. So it's a bit messy to do it, but it results in the socket being more reliable. And when you're developing a monitor ROM and things like that, you may very well find that you have to flash the code quite frequently. And rather than keeping on forcing the chip out of the breadboard with a screwdriver, for example, using a zero first insertion force socket, a much more reliable way of doing things. So similarly, with dip switches and LED bars, you might find that you need to find components with long enough leads, or you might have to do something with the leads that I've shown you for the zero insertion force sockets. Probably the most important thing, which is easy to forget, is making sure there's sufficient decoupling capacitors close to chip's power pins. Now, within breadboards, it's quite difficult to put the decoupling capacitors across pins 7 and 14 that you might find on a typical IC. But in general, as long as the decoupling capacitor is close to the ground pin, then that should be sufficient to minimize problems. And generally, designs will also include higher value electrolytic capacitors, 22 microfarads, 100 microfarads for power smoothing. So combination of the higher value capacitors and the decoupling capacitors, I tend to put one on every chip, and that should reduce the problems that you'll get from spikes on the power supplies and things like that. The other key thing here is good practice for all TTL logic is any unused input should be tied to ground or VCC. Again, there's a post here that Austin Morland has done here, which I'll reference. He's someone who's had a similar experiences with looking at Ben Eater's YouTube videos and going through a whole number of builds and rebuilding and whatever. So a lot of the some of the things I've been saying he's covered here. So sorting out your power distribution, finding the right sort of sockets and things for things, but in particular decoupling capacitors. So in his article here, he covers some of the problems that he's found and the confusion it caused him, and what my tips here are really summarizing some of the things that he's also identified here as well. So hopefully this will save people a lot of pain and suffering. The other thing I would say that you can't never have too much of is sort of ribbon cable with the various male, female plugs and sockets on. I've actually got quite a number of these. I tend to buy them in packs when I can, when they're in stock, because it never can have too many of them. So if we look at the pack I've got here, this is one I bought a few months ago. Typically, you will get packs of multiple lengths. So you normally get some nice short ones. So those are female-female, male-female, and male-to-male. And the colours do tend to be a fairly standard colour. When we look at logic probes in future videos, you'll see that does tend to be a fairly standard sort of colour sequence in these. So if you start to try and standardise on the colour sequence, it can make your life easier hooking things up. So those are the short ones. And then there's some medium length ones, probably the most useful ones. Again, you can see there's all the different male, female, and then the long ones. So these are probably more useful for plugging in test leads and things like that for logic analyzers, and perhaps for plugging in things like keypads and those sorts of things. But it's worthwhile having a number of these. I think this pack cost about £6 or £7, so they're not massively expensive and are really, really useful for simplifying layouts and things from time to time. So that's ribbon cable. Okay, and then we're on to our untidy rat's nest. So using the paper chip pin layout labels is certainly a big time saver. So I think I've already covered that. The other thing I've mentioned already is if designing schematic diagrams in KiCad, it's useful to change the logical layout that the schematic diagrams tend to use to physical pin layout, so they're in pin order. It does tend to mean then that when you're laying out your diagram, you can get a good idea of how things should be laid out on the physical board. There's also a tool called Fritzing, which is a useful tool for smaller breadboards and for doing strip board, Vera board type designs. I'll cover that in another video. It's probably too much to go through here. And as I said in the introduction video, planning layouts on printed out breadboard templates or in tool like Fritzing is easier than moving components during the build. So working out and planning out the way how you're going to plug these things in on the more complicated designs can save you quite a lot of time. And in fact, the Busboard Prototype Systems data sheet has quite a nice image here that if you screenshot this and paste into a document and duplicate it a number of times, you can print this out at either, you know, standard size or enlarged size, and it's quite handy for laying out things, particularly when you've got more complicated circuits and things. I'll be showing you when you come to the keypad and the LED display that in fact I've used Fritzing to do those layouts, and so I'll show you a little bit more of that later on in the series. The other thing I would strongly recommend is get a fairly accurate schematic printed out, and as you hook up wires, just tick off which ones are being connected. Make any corrections to your schematic as you go along. It's a lot easier to make sure that you've done everything than having to go back afterwards to see where you may have missed out particular wires and things. And as we've covered in the introduction video, that once you do the initial prototype and wire things in, leads tend to be a bit long and gangly. It's useful to rewire the circuit and actually do neater fitted wires, as Ben's tips video shows. I try and use fairly consistent color wires for the different signal types. So my own particular choice is red for the positive voltage, black for ground, white for data lines, green for address lines, blue for control signals, and yellow for input output related. What I would say is, even though I do have a jump wire kit, I don't tend to use the jump wire kit I show you this. This is a K&H one that came with some of the other breadboards I was showing the other day. And yeah, there's nothing wrong with the jump wires. They're nicely made jump wires, and they're all different sizes. But I prefer to have the colour indicates the function of the wire rather than the length of it. So whilst you can get these, and yeah, they're quite nice that they're all pre-cut to those sorts of sizes. With my little jig that I use for doing the shorter ones, then really a lot of the pain of handling the shorter ones can be eliminated. So I don't use those generally. And finally, using multiple rail breadboards to make buses. This one I showed you earlier. Obviously, I've wired these up, testing the capacitance and the resistance when you zigzag these things. Obviously, the most obvious improvement you could make if you were doing this is if you moved all these wires up to the end here, then you would reduce the path that it was doing by quite a significant amount. So you might just try doing that just for out of interest. So now if we get our meter out and we measure how much the resistance is, we actually put our wire between the two here closer. If you remember, I think we had about 2.6 ohms. If we just see what the resistance is there now. So there we go. So what we've done here, rather than having the current going all the way up and down every single one, we're just going up and down the breadboards here. We can now see that this is half an ohm. So we've lost probably about 2 ohms in resistance there. So the way how you wire these things up really does make a big difference, but it's worthwhile being aware that if you start to connect more than two or three of these things together, then you are going to start to have effects of resistance. And just remember that 0.1 of an ohm at 1 amp will lose you about 0.1 of a volt. So if you have that multiple times, then you could easily lose half a volt, which is going to start to get your 5 volt voltage down to a level where you might start to have some power supply problems. If you combine that also with the USB power supply may not be able to give you the full 5 volts, then you can quite easily get down towards 4 volts, which will start to give you reliability problems. Right, so let's go back to the last slide I have here, not finally. So breadboards can only be used for frequencies up to 1 megahertz, perhaps 10, due to residual capacitance and inductance. Now, whilst breadboards do have residual capacitance, there is an EE blog video of 568, I think, that Dave Jones did, which he tested the capacitance of the breadboard between the strips, the five-way strips, and between the power lines. And he think he found that between the individual five-hole strips, about 2 to 3 picofarads. My meter, unfortunately, doesn't go quite as low as that. And then when doing the power rails, they were about 20 picofarads, which is about right in that there are about 10 of these effectively in parallel from a capacitance point of view. So that would result in the capacitance being added together. So 2 to 3 picofarads times 10, we've got 10 lots of these holes, will actually result in about 20, 25 picofarads. That needs to be taken into account. It's not likely to be a big issue except for high frequency oscillators. I know when I was doing one of my things I'll talk about down here with the 25 megahertz crystal, then the sort of capacitance that you were using with that crystal was only probably about 5, 6, 7 picofarads. So it might start to become an issue with those. And so the power bus strips do have a capacitance of about 20 picofarads between rails. Now, when using these bus strips as perhaps a data or an address bus, then what that starts to indicate really is that you want to use buffer chips. So things like the 74LS541, which is very similar to the 241, but all of the pins are on the right side, correct side of the chip. So all the inputs are on one side, all the outputs on the other. The older 241s have them scrambled around. And the 245 bidirectional buffer, both of those chips have in their data sheets that they use test loads of 45 picofarads. So even if you had two of these bus rails joined together, then they're certainly going to be well within the capacitance range of these sorts of buffer chips. Whether or not the base processor itself will be able to cope with driving longer bus lines with higher capacitance is another matter. So in general, as we in future videos, we'll be going into some of the data sheets and looking at the data sheets as we're checking things off. And what we should find is that the 6809 is capable of driving 4 LSTTL loads. Now, with the number of chips we have on this particular design and with them being enabled and chip enabled, then in fact, we're unlikely to get more than 4 active TTO loads. So we don't really need any buffers at this point in time, but it's certainly something as we want to look at enhancing the design, we're probably going to want to add some buffer chips to the address and data buses to improve stability. Fairly obvious, keeping high frequency components close together with short wires. I had originally, when designing a 640 by 480 16 color VGA adapter, I had anticipated perhaps having to build some of the components on veraboard or strip board and then mounting that on the breadboard. But in fact, the higher frequency parts of that circuit are running at 25 megahertz and it produces quite a stable and good quality VGA signal on an LCD monitor. So really my experience has been that you can push this, if you're careful, to work at higher frequencies. And in fact, I was just doing an order the other day for a 40 megahertz crystal and perhaps for looking at some of the ALS chips, which are capable of going a little bit faster than the standard LSTTL, and see if I can actually push that VGA adapter to super VGA resolution of 800 by 600 just for fun. So that's be coming up in later videos in the series, but we've got quite a bit to get through first. So that's my tips for reliable breadboard projects. I hope you found it interesting. Please hit subscribe and click on the like buttons if you found that useful. There is a playlist for the NanoComp 6809 microcomputer being built on breadboards that will be with the end of the video here. Please click on that if you want to see a whole series of videos where these hints and tips will be used to build a working computer with its own keypad and LED display. Thanks for watching.